good neighbor looks beyond external accidents of race, gender, or circumstance. A good neighbor discerns the inner qualities that make us all human. A good neighbor knows we are all family. Martin Luther King Jr.
And now, please join Liam in saying the words to accompany lighting the chalice.
Darkness cannot drive out darkness. Only light can do that. Hate cannot drive out hate. Only love can do that.
Understanding from people of goodwill is more frustrating than absolute misunderstanding from people of ill will. The function of education is to teach one to think intensively and to think critically.
Shallow understanding from people of goodwill. That is a sobering phrase. And we realize that it's important to learn the history we were never taught and to be aware of things that happen all the time that don't make the regular news feeds. Our own history, things we can be proud of as a nation and in our congregation, and the things that we have denied or ignored about how deeply unfair things have been for a very, very, very long time. In 1965, Dr. King gave a sermon in which he said, more than ever before, 1965, more than ever before, America is challenged to realize its dream, for the shape of the world does not permit our nation the luxury of an anemic democracy. You might think that statement is truer today than it was 55 years ago. You might be right. We are challenged, we are so challenged to live in awareness of our inescapable mutuality and to embrace all people as our neighbors. Some of us were moved to participate in the USNF The Vote effort after we watched the film about voter suppression in Georgia. I think that was late September or October. And from then on, so many of us, over the summer, even before that, and then from then on, so many of us worked up until the amazing outcome of the Georgia Senate runoff election. Our racial justice work continues. It includes ongoing opportunities for education and for action, including strengthening democracy, fighting for climate legislation, and championing other reforms. And all of these are related. They are part of that network of inescapable mutuality that Dr. King invoked. We still have a lot to learn. In August of 1619, a ship arrived in Point Comfort, Virginia, which was carrying more than 20 enslaved Africans. Those were the first on record to be brought to the English colony of Virginia. And they were among the 12.5 million Africans forced into the transatlantic slave trade, their journey to the New World today known as the Middle Passage. 400 years later, in August of 2019, the New York Times published an edition of their Sunday magazine as part of an effort that they called the 1619 Project. All of the contributors to that project are people of African descent, and the project is dedicated to highlighting the history of Black American people, their struggles, their accomplishments, the reality of their lived experience, and the truths of the obstacles they have faced and continue to face. Part of our work this year is to offer monthly conversations based on podcasts from the 1619 Project. That will begin in late January or in February. And we have two readings from that project this morning. The first one will be read by Annika Johnson.
Hi, everyone. My name's Annika. I'm a former youth grouper at the USNF Church, and I'm also currently an RE volunteer. This is a poem from the 1619 Project by Clint Smith. Over the course of 300 years, 36,000 slave ships crossed the Atlantic Ocean. I walk over to the globe and move, my finger back and forth between the fragile continents. I try to keep count how many times I drag my hand across the bristled hemispheres, but grow wary of chasing a history that swallowed me. For every 100 people who were captured and enslaved, 40 died before they ever reached the New World. I slide my ring finger from Senegal to South Carolina and feel the ocean separate a million families. The soft hum of history spins on its tilted axis. A cavalcade of ghost ships wash their hands of all they carried. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Nancy Sardison, and I'm a grateful member of the Society and a member of the Racial Justice Team. Here's a reading from Nicole Hannah-Jones, a Black staff writer at the New York Times Magazine and the creator of the 1619 Project. Nicole Hannah-Jones. My dad always flew an American flag in our front yard. The blue paint on our two-story house was perennially chipping. The fence or the rail by the stairs or the front door existed in a perpetual state of disrepair, but that flag always flew pristine. Our corner lot, which had been redlined by the federal government, was along the river that divided the Black side from the white side of our Iowa town. At the edge of our lawn, high on an aluminum pole, soared the flag. When I was young, that flag outside our home never made sense to me. How could this Black man, having seen firsthand the way his country abused Black Americans, how it refused to treat us as full citizens, proudly fly its banner? It deeply embarrassed me. I had been taught that our history as a people began with enslavement and that we had contributed little to this great nation. That my dad felt so honored in being an American felt like a marker of his degradation, his acceptance of his subordination. Before the abolishment of the international slave trade, 400,000 enslaved Americans would be sold into America. Those individuals and their descendants transformed the land to which they'd been brought into into some of the most successful colonies in the British Empire. Through backbreaking labor, they cleared the land across the southeast. They taught the colonists to grow rice. They grew and picked cotton that at that time, at the height of the slavery, was the nation's most valuable crop, accounting for half of all American exports and 66% of the world's supply. Profits from the Black people's stolen labor helped the young nation pay off its war debt and finance some of our most prestigious universities. It was the relentless buying, selling, insuring, and financing of their bodies and the products of their labor that made Wall Street a thriving banking, insurance, and trading sector, and New York City the financial capital of the world. My father knew what it would take me years to understand, that the year 1619 is as important to the American story as 1776, that Black Americans, as much as those men cast in alabaster in the nation's capital, are this nation's true founding fathers, and that no people has a greater claim to that flag than us.
So please take a look at the picture behind me. That is a large drawing that Harriet Diamond, who is one of our artist members, made, I don't know how many years ago. It hung in the living room of the well-known activist Frances Crowe for many years. And Harriet made that drawing after she told me hearing a story about the famous abolitionist Sojourner Truth. So in the mid-1840s, Truth, who was a former slave in New York, was living right here in Florence, working and participating in the life of the Northampton Association for Arts and Industry. And that association was in a utopian community that was devoted to social and economic equality for all people, regardless of race or background or religious beliefs or gender. And later, in the 1860s, some of the former members of that association founded the Free Congregational Society of Florence, which was very much still inspired by the values of the Northampton Association. The Free Congregational Society of Florence is one of our two forebearer congregations. And so Sojourner Truth, in a small way, is one of our special ancestors. She was famous for her speeches, her singing, her preaching, and she was a famous abolitionist who convinced many people that slavery was wrong. So here's the story. In the spring of 1844, Sojourner Truth was scheduled to be one of the preachers at a tent meeting in a farm field in Hadley, right here in Hadley. A mob of men who had been drinking burst into the services, terrifying the worshipers and threatening to burn down all the tents. And so they fled inside, all the participants and the preachers fled inside the tents, and as the men were shaking the tents, she says she had a little talk with herself, and she said, "Shall I run away and hide from the devil? Have I not faith enough to go out and quell that mob when I know it is written, 'One shall chase 1,000 and two put 10,000 to flight'? I'll go to the rescue." So she urged other preachers and participants to help, but they said no. So she walked out alone to a high place. Some say she got up on a wagon, and she began singing with all the strength of her powerful voice. And then she started to preach, beginning with a riff on something from the Bible about Judgment Day. She said, "Well, there are two congregations right here on this ground. It is written that there shall be a separation and the sheep shall be separated from the goats. Looks like the other preachers have the sheep and I have the goats." Well, luckily the crowd laughed at being described as the goats. And they, from then on, they were mesmerized. She preached and she sang for the better part of an hour. When she got tired and wanted to stop, they wouldn't let her go. And finally, she said, "I'll sing one more song if you will then promise to leave in peace afterwards." She did that, and the troublemakers left, not quietly necessarily, but they didn't harass anyone else. And people said that some of them found grace that day. They found faith. Please join now in singing together Amazing Grace.
And now it's time for us to greet one another. So you're invited to turn on your video. You can wave, you can say hi in the chat. If you're new or new-ish, feel free to type a message in the chat and say hello to everybody and let us know where you are from.
Hello, 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 hello. I had the great fun of admitting a lot of you from the waiting room this morning. Anybody who came after 9:59, I might have been the person letting you in, and it was so wonderful to see all your names. It was just, it was really, really moving and fun to see you all. So welcome, welcome. And I don't know how many screens, 7 screens to see everyone. So it's so great to see you all. If you are new, welcome. If you haven't been here for a while, it's great to see you again. Oh, and more Janets, 2 Janets right next to each other. Wow. Laura S., great to see you. Hey, Rick. I could go down the list, but hello, Peggy Mish. Hello, Larry Perellis. Great to see you. Kathy. And oh, there's the 4th Janet. Hello, Janet. Runas, Teresa, and, oh, hi, Christine, nice to see you. I haven't seen Teresa's daughter before. Eleanor, Sherry, Kim, Carmen, oh, wonderful, wonderful. Wonderful to see you all. Jessica says hi, everyone she gets to talk to. And then three pages of names. So great to see you. What are we doing next? Now what happens, everybody? Offering? Yeah, there is none. All right. We can turn off our videos now. Great to be good to be part of a trend, Janet says. Yes. So before we talk about the offering, which we, I want you to know that this week on Tuesday at 5:30, there is a national moment of mourning and recognition for everyone who has died from COVID-19. Towns, cities, homes, everyone is invited to turn on their lights, and there will be church bells ringing downtown, and we don't have a church bell, but members of the board, some of the members of the board and I, and maybe some of the staff will stand on our steps. We'll turn on the lights in our building and we'll stand on the steps and ring bells as part of that celebration and part of that acknowledgement. And there will be a link, I think it's in the Sunday Times, but there will also be a link in the Tuesday newsletter. If you're interested in it'll just be brief, if you're interested in seeing us as that happens. So now is a time to enjoy Lemmy's music as we consider all the gifts that this community brings to us and all the ways in which we can share our bounty with the wider world. Our morning offering will be given and received, and we'll take time for the offering.
Thank you.
love your enemies. Do I sound like most preachers, idealistic and impractical? My friends, we have followed the so-called practical way for too long a time. For the salvation of our nations and the salvation of humankind, we must follow another way. Martin Luther King.
Good morning. Our story this morning is called Each Kindness by Jacqueline Woodson, who's one of my favorite young adult and children's book authors. She's also started writing books for adults too, which is nice for the rest of you all. She's a well-known Black author, and she paired up with E.B. Lewis, who's our illustrator, who's a Black illustrator, and he's won many awards and teaches in Philadelphia. That winter, snow filled everything, turning the world brilliant white. One morning, as we settled into our seats, the classroom door opened and the principal came in. She had a girl with her, and she said to us, "This is Maya." Maya looked down at the floor. I think I heard her whisper hello. We all stared at her. Her coat was open, and the clothes beneath it looked old and ragged. Her shoes were spring shoes, not meant for the snow. A strap on one of them had broken. Our teacher, Miss Albert, said, "Say good morning to our new student," but most of us were silent. The only empty seat was next to me. That's where our teacher put Maya. And on that first day, Maya turned to me and smiled, but I didn't smile back. I moved my chair, myself, and my books a little farther away from her. When she looked my way, I turned to the window and stared out at the snow. And every day after that, when Maya came into the classroom, I looked away and didn't smile back. My best friends that year were Kendra and Sophie. At lunchtime, we walked around the schoolyard, our fingers laced together, whispering secrets into each other's ears. One day, while we were near the slide, Maya came over to us. She held open her hands to show us the shiny jacks and tiny red ball she'd gotten for her birthday. "It's a high bouncer," she said. None of us wanted to play, so Maya played a game against herself. That afternoon, when we got back into the classroom, Maya whispered to me, "Bet you can't guess who's the new jacks champion of the world." Behind me, Andrew whispered, "Chloe's got a new friend. Chloe's got a new friend." "She's not my friend," I whispered back. The weeks passed. Every day we whispered about Maya, laughing at her clothes, her shoes, the strange food she brought for lunch. Some days Maya held out her hand to show us what she had brought to school, a deck of cards, pickup sticks, a small tattered doll. Whenever she asked us to play, we said no. The days grew warmer and warmer. The pond thawed. Grass began growing where snow had once been. One day, Maya came to school wearing a pretty dress and fancy shoes. But the shoes and the dress looked like they belonged to another girl before Maya. "I have a new name for her," Kendra whispered. "Never knew. Everything she has comes from a secondhand store." We all laughed. Maya stood by the fence. She was holding a jump rope, but did not come over to ask us if we wanted to play. After a while, she folded it double, rolled the ends around each hand, and started jumping. She jumped around the whole schoolyard without stopping. She didn't look up once, just jumped, jumped, jumped. The next day, Maya's seat was empty. In class that morning, we were talking about kindness. Mrs. Albert had brought a big bowl into class and filled it with water. We all gathered around her desk and watched her drop a small stone into it. Tiny waves rippled out away from the stone. "This is what kindness does," Miss Albert said. "Each little thing we do goes out like a ripple into the world." Then Miss Albert had each of us drop a stone in as we told her what kind things we had done. Joseph had held the door of his grandmother. Kendra helped change her baby brother's diaper. Even mean old Andrew had done something. "I carried teacher's books up the stairs," he said. And Miss Albert said it was true. I stood there, holding the rock in my hands, silent. "Even small things count," Miss Albert said gently. But I couldn't think of anything, and pass the stone on. Maya didn't come to school the next day or the day after that. Each morning, I walked to school slowly, hoping this would be the day Maya returned. And she'd look at me and smile. I promised myself that this would be the day I smiled back. Each kindness, Miss Albert had said, makes the whole world a little better. But Maya's seat remained empty. And one day, Miss Albert announced to the class that Maya wouldn't be coming back. Her family had to move away, Miss Albert said. Then she told us to take out our notebooks. It was time for spelling. That afternoon, I walked home alone. When I reached the pond, my throat filled with all the kind things I wish I would have said to Maya, each kindness I had never shown. I threw small stones out onto the pond over and over, watching the way the water ripples out and away, like each kindness done and not done, like every girl somewhere holding a small gift out to someone, and that someone turning away from it. I watched the water ripple as the sun set through the maples, and the chance of a kindness with Maya became more and more forever gone.
How does that story make you feel? It makes me feel sad. Sad for Maya, but also really sad for the girl who wishes she hadn't been so mean. It reminds me of the times that I've been mean, that I am mean. It makes me sad for all the meanness around us. Loving our neighbors, especially when we don't find them likable, takes practice. It takes self-awareness and an ability to regulate our reactions to our own feelings. It's a way to help us practice, though, living our Unitarian Universalist values, respecting all beings and remembering that we are all connected and all interdependent. So our learning to lead in love dialogue work will provide us with opportunities to practice. And in case you haven't heard about them, there are 30 steps to work on individually on our own over 4 or 5 months or more. Every step involves reflection, and then many of them allow us to practice having conversations. Practice conversations with people whose opinions we don't find lovable, but with whom we might over time discover common ground. The goal, there are many goals. The goal of the designer of the program is to help change the social climate of the country one interaction at a time, to change people's understanding of race relations and racial justice one person at a time. Little steps to change racial animosity and political animosity, to damp down to the heightened reactivity and vitriol that is poisoning all of us. When I wrote this, we had 40 people signed up. We now have over 50. And I hope that we might still, maybe not double, but at least increase it again by half. The program starts the end of this month. You can email dialogues@uunorthampton.org if you have questions about it. And I really hope that many more of you will join us. And now please join us in singing the beautiful song that was popularized by the group Ma Muse, We Shall Be Known.
We shall be known by the ground, we be green, by the
Parker Palmer writes, "Bridge building has never been easy. We all have vital local roles to play. And our task must be done from an inner place of nonviolence. For me, that means a steady search for inner peace through practice, even as I seek ways to bring peace to the world around me." Ruth King, in her book, Mindful About Race, advises using mindfulness practice to learn how to get still and simply receive the present moment. When we are still, she writes, we can ask ourselves, is how I'm thinking, feeling, and acting contributing to suffering or to freedom? Picture the little girl, Chloe, in our story. Like her, we can ask, what ripples have I made? I invite you to watch the ripples of water on your screen that you will soon see, and to hold in your minds and hearts ripples of kindness, ripples of peace, ripples of understanding, as we commit to doing what we can together.
In the final analysis, the church has a purpose. It is dealing with humanity's ultimate concern, and therefore it has certain guidelines that it must follow. To preach good news to the poor, to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, to set at liberty those who are bruised. These are the guidelines.
Good morning. I'm Kim Henrichon, the Society's president. In June of 2017, the UUA appointed a commission to, quote, conduct an audit of the power structures and analyze systemic racism and white supremacy culture within the Unitarian Universalist Association, unquote. The commission issued its report called Widening the Circle, Widening the Circle of Concern, last spring. One of the commission members, a white woman named Mary Byron, wrote this. Keeping quiet, doing nothing, isn't an option for me. White people built economic, housing, justice, immigration, environmental, and education systems that create inequitable outcomes, and white people are required to dismantle them. I knew I needed to be willing to get uncomfortable, to start by acknowledging my role in our dominant white culture and the ways I participate in upholding it. It is hard to see these things in myself, but I need to see and change in order to live into the UU principles I believe. Our ongoing racial justice work at the Unitarian Society will include engaging with the Widening of the Circle report. It will be an opportunity for us to look at institutional racism right here in this place we care deeply about. We hope the work will help us notice how white supremacy culture plays out all around us and how we can start to question and dismantle these systems, because this is a critical part of our purpose. This winter and spring, as you have heard, we are running numerous offerings that will help us to learn and develop as we get uncomfortable in our efforts to not do nothing. The Leading in Love dialogue workshops that Janet just spoke of, the 1619 project conversations that we heard a piece of this morning, book groups and other similar projects that will serve as foundation to more active endeavors moving forward. Then we will begin engaging more directly with the Widening the Circle report in the fall. In the meantime, we hope many of you will read this landmark report. We have copies available in the office for people to borrow and share, and it's also freely available on the UUA website electronically. You can see the Sunday Times for further information. Thank you.
So it is, as we know, more than ever painfully and heart-wrenchingly clear that our nation is divided in deep and frightening ways, and at the core of those divisions is the very ugly history of oppression and exploitation founded on racial oppression and hatred. The violence we've recently seen bears witness to how powerful that history is, and to how cynically and systematically powerful people manipulate and incite others to act on their basest instincts. In the sermon that Booker just quoted from, which was given, I think, in 1966, Dr. King is critical of churches and clergy. He's specifically calling out Black churches and Black clergy that serve as social clubs, Black ministers who have forgotten the guidelines. In the final analysis, the church has a purpose. It is dealing with humanity's ultimate concern. Humanity's ultimate concern. He reminds us that it's up to all of us to ask ourselves, today, now, about purpose. Our purpose as a religious community, our purpose as individuals, our purpose as citizens of this nation and of the planet. To heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, to set at liberty those who are bruised, to hold one another accountable for loving our neighbors in ways that are tangible and real. I hope you'll join us Tuesday night for just a moment in solidarity as we look forward with hope to a new day in Washington, and as we commit ourselves to the work, the ongoing work that we need to do together. Now let's join in singing together, "We Shall Overcome." Go in hope, go in courage, and go in peace. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you to our entire worship team this morning. Our staff, Lemmy Grotowski and Jessica Harwood, our amazing tech team of Steve O'Day and Rebecca Smith, Abby Shodoff, Dave Beauvais, Booker Bush. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. And thank you all for being here. There's a wonderful concert this afternoon at 4 on the Live from the Sanctuary website, or you can get to the link from our website. Morningstar, Chenvin, and Moonlight Davis are playing it from the Sanctuary at 4 o'clock. It's a fabulous, fabulous concert.
Breakout groups for social hours.